Let us take up our songbooks to Psalm 119, F, and praise the Lord with the words thereof. So that's from a section from Psalm 119. Thy word forever is, O Lord, in heaven settled fast, and unto generations all thy faithfulness doth last. And we'll stand to sing these six verses, and the last verse we'll sing a cappella, please. Let's continue the public worship of God in public prayer together and call upon his name, who has the name above all names. Let us pray. Glorious and almighty and merciful Jehovah, Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, eternally perfect and blessed, Thou Holy Lord, we call upon Thee only in the name of Thy Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank Thee, Lord, for that precious access that we have, that the ears of the eternal God are open to our cries because of Him. We thank Thee for that new and blood-sprinkled way, the blood that speaks better things than that of Abel's, the blood that speaks of peace, of atonement, of forgiveness, that we may approach Thee, O Lord, in prayer because of Christ. O Lord, we do pray Thee this morning as we come into Thy holy presence upon Thy day in Thy house, that we should be mindful, O Lord, that we have sinned against Thee, that where Thy word clearly declares Thy holiness and Thy righteousness and Thy goodness, And yet we are not holy or righteous or good. We have sinned against thee. And we pray, O Lord, that thou wilt cause our hearts and our consciences to grieve for sin, that thou would increase thy fear within each and every one of us, that we sin not against thee. Lord, would thou have mercy, and would thou forgive thy children their sins. Cleanse us afresh, and we thank thee, Lord, that thou art faithful and just to forgive us our sins, that we confess before thee, seeking thy forgiveness, and that thou wilt cleanse us from all unrighteousness, Lord, even now legally, but there will be that time coming when redemption has reached its full point. It is the consummation of redemption when we will be truly and eternally cleansed, body and soul, and that we may abide in the glorious holiness of God and dwelling with God. And, O Lord, we pray for those who know nothing of the forgiveness of God, who are outside of Christ, have not called upon his name. And we call upon thee, O Lord, to be merciful to them. We have touched upon in the past, Lord, the rich mercies of God, that thy mercy endureth forever. And we pray, O Lord, that that eternal and infinite mercy may even be shown this morning unto undeserving sinners, that something of the gospel truths will enter in, that thy spirit will be pleased to open hearts as thou didst open the heart and mind of Lydia. Lord, wilt thou remember us for good this morning, and remember those that need thy touch, those who are unwell, those who are unable to come out because of sickness or because of age or other matters. The Lord, that thou would draw nigh unto them, thou the God of all comfort, to give that comfort, that help, that balm to the heart, but also that strengthening to the soul. Lord, give that help, we pray. And Lord, we do pray for that we may have a fresh meeting with the Lord this morning, who is in our midst. Lord, that we may know the blessing of Christ, the strengthening of Christ, that as the word of Christ goes forth, Lord, that we may know that strengthening and sanctifying work. We pray, O Lord, that all that is said and done will redound to the glory of God, but that, Lord, that the words would be simple enough that even the youngest might understand something. O Lord, remember the needs of this land, a land in full-out apostasy and under thy wrath. And we do pray for all those in power, for all men and for kings. And we pray, O Lord, that thou would restrain them from their wickedness. And we pray also, Lord, that thou wouldst give them wisdom and thy fear. We pray also that the godless would be removed from power, the unrepentant and unchangeable, unchanging godless. And Lord, that thou would put the godly in power, those that fear thee, Lord, those that know thee. We pray for great revivals and awakenings and reformations across this land, a land that is so pleased with itself and yet is so Christless. Lord, wilt thou have mercy? Wilt thou hear this, our prayer? Remember Chanson also. We thank thee, Lord, for again what we see to be improvements, more movement, more reaction to external stimuli. Lord, wilt thou have mercy and raise that young man up to full health. Lord, it's good to see Isaiah back in our midst. We thank thee, Lord, for thy hand of keeping upon him. And we pray for thy blessing upon him and all that he endeavors to do for thine own glory. Remember also those ministers in the denomination that are needing visas. We thank thee for providing that green card to Reverend and Mrs. Pollock and their eldest, and that for the children it's still in the process. But do remember our brother Reverend Simpson up in Prince George, Reverend Tomassian there in Greenville. And remember, also mindful of Mr. Dunbar. Lord, we do thank thee for that lung transplant that he had, although he collapsed at the beginning of this week. Lord, we thank thee that he was helped, and that there was some pneumonia was found at the bottom of one lung. And we do pray, Lord, that the treatment would be successful, that thou would indeed raise him up to full health as a man of his age may be expected to receive. But Lord, we do humbly thank thee for every petition and every prayer that thou hast heard concerning this man, concerning Chance, and concerning so many other matters at the moment. I do remember those that need thy touch. Lord, remember our brother Merle and that ongoing situation with his health. I remember the Clock family also expecting their third child. We pray that all may go well in the final weeks of pregnancy. And Lord, will thou hear our prayer? May we know thee closely and in our presence today. And may thy word truly enter in. May it convert those that need conversion. And may it restore those that who are backslidden. And may it sanctify all of thy flock, that thy word will have its full effect, that we may know that precious washing of the word. For we pray in Christ's name only. Amen. Amen. I'd ask our brother Deacon Caleb Strook to come before we take the offering to give a word of prayer, thanksgiving for the offerings, and then immediately after the offering will be taken, we'll remain seated, and then we'll sing Amazing Grace, hymn 247. Brother, thank you.
Lord, as we come here this day, Lord, on thy day, we recognize, Lord, we are a small part of thy kingdom, Lord. Lord, yet we are grateful for this place here, Lord, how thou hast brought us together, Lord, united in Christ. We pray, Lord, that you would meet with us here this morning, that you would bless the word to our hearts. We thank thee also, Lord, for the means of provision, O Lord, for each of us. And as we give back a small portion unto thee, O Lord, that you would use it not only for this place, but for thy kingdom's sake, O Lord, in this land and for nations abroad, that thy word would be spread throughout and truth would go forward, O Lord. We do pray in Jesus' name.
Please open your copies of God's Word to the first book of Moses, that is Genesis, the first book of the Bible, and chapter 8. Genesis chapter 8. There are copies of God's Word in front of you in the pew, if you have not one with you. Genesis chapter 8. And we read from verse 20 of chapter 8 and read up to verse 17 of chapter 9. And it is that with the Lord's gracious help this morning that we'll be looking at the first seven verses of chapter 9. But we will read from verse 20 of chapter 8. Genesis chapter 8 and verse 20. And Noah builded an altar unto the Lord, and took of every clean beast and of every clean fowl, and offered burnt offerings on the altar. And the Lord smelled a sweet savour, and the Lord said in his heart, I will not again curse the ground any more for man's sake, for the imagination of man's heart is evil from his youth. Neither will I again smite any more everything living, as I have done. While the earth remaineth, seed time and harvest, and cold and heat, and summer and winter, and day and night shall not cease. And God blessed Noah and his sons, and said unto them, Be fruitful and multiply, and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require. At the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother, will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. And you, be ye fruitful, and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein. And God spake unto Noah and to his sons with him, saying, And I, behold, I establish my covenant with you, and with your seed after you, and with every living creature that is with you, of the fowl, of the cattle, and of every beast of the earth with you, from all that go out of the ark to every beast of the earth. And I will establish my covenant with you. Neither shall all flesh be cut off any more by the waters of a flood, neither shall there any more be a flood to destroy the earth. And God said, This is the token of the covenant which I make between me and you and every living creature that is with you for perpetual generations. I do set my bow in the cloud, and it shall be for a token of a covenant between me and the earth. And it shall come to pass, when I bring a cloud over the earth, that the bow shall be seen in the cloud. And I will remember my covenant, which is between me and you, and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall no more become a flood to destroy all flesh. And the bow shall be in the cloud, and I will look upon it, that I may remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is upon the earth. And God said unto Noah, This is the token of the covenant which I have established between me and all flesh that is upon the earth. Amen. As I mentioned, the text for the preaching of God's holy and infallible word this morning is taken from verses 1 to 7. Verses 1 to 7. And we will call upon the Lord for that much needed illumination and help in the preaching and the reading of the word. And And we'll read those verses again together shortly. Let us pray, please. Lord, we give thee thanks and praise that thou hast been pleased to open thy mouth in our hearing the voice of God through the word of God. We have heard, O Lord, these wonderful truths, deep truths, many of which are yet to be opened up in the preaching. And yet we do desire, O Lord, that thou would open our ears, giving us teachable spirits, give us understanding, and soften our necks, that we be not stiff-necked. Lord, that we would be humble before thee. Humble us, Lord. We need humbling. And grant us that faith that is needed to hear the word, and faith that cometh by the hearing of the word. Grant unto me, Lord, all that is needed, the graces from heaven, the unction of the Spirit, to preach thy word, not as a display of man's wisdom, but by the power of the Spirit. We need thy Spirit, O Lord, this morning, that we may truly worship thee. Hear us in Jesus' name, and for his everlasting glory. Amen. Verses 1 to 7. We read together. And God blessed Noah and his sons, and said unto them, Be fruitful, and multiply, and replenish the earth. And the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea. Into your hand are they delivered. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat, that is food for you. Even as the green herb have I given you all things. But flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall ye not eat. And surely your blood of your lives will I require at the hand of every beast, will I require it, and at the hand of man, at the hand of every man's brother, will I require the life of man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. For in the image of God made he man. And you be ye fruitful, and multiply, bring forth abundantly in the earth, and multiply therein. Amen. The taking of another human life, it takes many and varied forms, some of which are very obvious that we see around us, murder. The breaking of the sixth commandment there. Euthanasia is one that's broadening out its tentacles of evil in this land through the statute books, through the wickedness that's been brought upon this land. Abortion, the murder of the unborn. War itself, of course, is a great calamity, killing young and old, wiping away generations of fathers and brothers. Violence in general, there's plenty of violence on the streets, and violence is often connected with the supply and the abuse of drugs, which in and of itself is also that which leads to death, causes death, has death all around it. But even something that might seem less innocuous, what about the dangerous sports that people involve themselves in? Risky sports. Doing anything just to get that massive rush of adrenaline. I would say all these aspects of the taking of human life, and of course suicide, the taking of your own life, they all reveal something about fallen and sinful man. Does that corruptedness? What is so special? What is so special for everybody is life. Is life, to enjoy life and even to witness other people enjoying lives. And yet there is that rot at the very core of man's moral and spiritual, yea, also physical being, that speaks of death, that desires death in all sorts of hypocritical ways as well. People driving down the highway, and then someone cuts them up, and the first thing that comes up in their head is not necessarily, oh, that was a close call, and gratefulness, thankfulness to the Lord for preservation. That might be there in the gracious believer. But maybe not as first. What's the first that comes up in the nature, in the sinful nature of man? It's cursing. It's cursings of death. He'd have them killed because they drove a little bit too close and there was a danger. They were not wise indeed. But because of that, you've declared the death penalty upon them. And if at that moment, with the emotions still raised, and you would have no one to hold your hand back, you could easily kill them. So great is the rage of the sinful nature. And yet we would say, keep your hands off me. Keep away from me. Let me live freely. And so what is that thing that's really rotten at the core of the nature of men and women, boys and girls, is an overwhelming undervaluing of what human life is. A depreciation, to use a bigger word, of just having no understanding of the great value that there is in human life. Yes, your own, because you're selfish, but others. And just to bring in a very modern matter, is how many Russian soldiers have been killed as cannon fodder in the Ukraine in the last number of weeks. Thousands. And the numbers are difficult to come by, but if we believe the Ukrainians, thousands, if we believe the Russians, 50, for example. But they've lost their lives, they've been sent as political pawns in a geopolitical game of chess. They are merely being moved forward and then they're being taken. But we're talking about lives. We're talking about fathers, we're talking about brothers, we're talking about uncles, we're talking about nephews, we're talking about friends, we're talking about, did I mention husbands? But we know that many of these, especially in the first wave, or at least if we can believe what's been said on the media, either pro-Ukraine or pro-Russian, it's all propaganda. But many said that they were only going on exercises within Russia. They were just coming near the border. They were just going on exercises. They had 3 days of rations, and then they're shoved over the border, and then they're really using live weapons against live targets, according to their witness. And so the logistics for fuel and food were dire, and they still are dire, which is why they're looting. According to footage that you may have seen yourself. So what am I pointing to in bringing this into the pulpit this morning? Well, the man behind all of this, really Vladimir Putin, or at least the man that we see being behind all of this, Vladimir Putin, he says that he has a deep love for Russia and for the Russian people. But I would suggest to you that his love for the Russian people is nowhere near as his love for his own ideologies, for his own maybe political aggrandizement, there's a great word, or to build himself up politically in the eyes of himself and others, because he seems to put very little value on human life, whether it be Ukrainian or whether it be Russian. And judging by his past deeds in the last 15, 20 years, doesn't seem to have much value for Chechen blood or for Georgian blood or for Syrian blood. And by no means am I saying that any other nation is nowhere near as guilty as he is. He's just a very clear and modern and pressing example. But that's an expression really of what the whole world has a problem with. And in the world today we see that the thinking of the world and the policies of the world and the attitude of the world towards human life, to the value of human life, has been heavily infiltrated, inundated, affected, poisoned, is maybe even better word to be said, by unbiblical and self-righteous philosophies and false religions. And they would all have us believe that human life is not as precious or as special, certainly not as it was once thought. And if your religion believes in reincarnation, then okay, you have a difficult life now, but hopefully if you pay the priest enough and you do enough of those rites and rituals, then you'll come back as something better next time. And therefore, incarnation teaches to devalue your life now, because you think there's always another chance. As does false Christianities that would teach that there's a chance of being saved after death. That once you die, then there might be grace enough for you to be converted still. It's not just unbiblical, but it's contrary to clear biblical teaching. that while it is today in this life that you hear the gospel, harden not your heart. Because there is no second chance. You have 365 days of chance every single year. You have more than one chance in God's grace, as it were, humanly speaking. So human life is not as precious or as special as we once thought, because of course the Christian worldview is to be despised and ignored. But also animal life is now just as precious as human life, if not more so. So again, we have this change as evolution has brought in and attempts to bring man down from the image of God that he has and from the position that God has put him on the earth is they want to bring them down to make them equal. Yeah, we're just sort of monkeys, naked apes, nothing more, nothing less. Well, in truth, less, because now we must do our best to keep animals and to worship almost the creation as opposed to the creator. And what are we? We are now called viruses, for example, in a very negative. If you've never heard that, then you're blessed. But that's one of the attitudes that they have, that human beings almost have no right to be on this planet. Well, except the ultra rich, of course, but that's their idea. All human life is worthless except their own worthless human lives. But in our text this morning, we're confronted with a completely different understanding of what life is, a completely different understanding, and it's God's view. It's God's view. It's the view of the source of life and he who is the sustainer of life, and those two aspects are very strong in the verses we have this morning. And therefore, because it is the view of the creator and sustainer of life, then therefore it is the only view that we should listen to and follow, because he knows. Being the creator, he knows how things are supposed to work because he has decreed it. And being the sustainer of life, he knows how we are to live to get the greatest blessings from him. But being the creator, he's also the judge and he knows all things. So what he says goes as creator, as judge, as the witness who was there when he created all things. But he is this great standard maker. He sets the standards. Not some mentally diseased, lapsed Jew from Germany living in London, and I'm talking of Karl Marx, from the 1850s, or anyone else. It's God who knows all these matters, and we are his possession. So he's owner, he's creator, he's judge, and he is the only source of truth. And therefore, we must take his view as our view. If you would like to know what was around the corner, if you would like to know that was something that was over the hill, but you were too small and you were too far away to see what was over the hill, to have a better perspective, to understand what was coming next, then you need to take the advice, you need to listen to someone who has seen what is over the hill, who is maybe standing on the crown of the hill and can look over. We need to realize that we have limitations in our own understanding and our own perception and certainly in our own experience. And so not only are we to seek that which is from seek that information from someone who knows better, but from someone who's teaching us this morning that he knows better, and therefore we must take his word as truth. Now, the fact that the Creator sets the standards and that he judges our breaking us of his standards, and that's what we see very much so in the context of what we have here. And the context is the leaving of the ark. They've been in the ark for many days, a year and a bit. And they're entering into the new world. We saw that last time with the sacrifices that Noah made. But we see this is a new world, and we see there are new blessings. We looked at the promises at the end of chapter 8. But there are new blessings, there are new relationships are also given to some degree. And all of which are there to encourage and to maintain the truth of the matter that the precious divine image of God rests upon and in man. The precious divine image With the Lord's gracious help this morning, we will see in these first seven verses of chapter 9, firstly, the blessings of life, the blessings of life. And as we open up verse 1 of chapter 9, we see the benediction of fruitfulness. There is a benediction of fruitfulness spoken out over Noah and his sons in verse 1, and God blessed Noah and his sons and said unto them, be fruitful and multiply and replenish the earth. And so with the closing verses of chapter 8 and the promises that were given, and that the beasts and the birds, when they were coming out, what did we notice? What did we notice? Not just in the last few verses, but the last verses from verse 15 onwards. We noticed this, and we made a point of it last time, that when the Lord said in verse 17 of chapter 8, bring forth with thee every living thing that is with thee of all flesh. And then it went on to say at the second part of that verse, that they may breed abundantly in the earth and be fruitful and multiply upon the earth. And we notice this, that here was no new benediction spoken out over the birds and over the beasts and over the fish to go forth and multiply, because that had already been spoken out. That had been clearly spoken out. They did not receive a new benediction and bidding to be fruitful and multiply. It would seem that the one that was spoken out upon them on the fifth and the sixth day would be sufficient, it would appear. But what do we see here, though? We do see clearly in verse 1 and verse 7 of chapter 9 that mankind, specifically Noah and his sons, as those that would father the new life, that they received a special blessing. That mankind and malekind, but mankind in general, but also malekind specifically, are given a special blessing to be fruitful and multiply, to be able to father many. And they do receive it. In fact, you could understand this as receiving a double portion of that blessing. Mankind has received it already, but now Noah goes out and with his family and into this new earth, this new creation, this new chance, this new opportunity, and they receive a double blessing of God. The first blessing we read in Genesis 1 and 28 with very similar language to as we have here in verses 1 and verse 7. You might notice if you were to read that verse 28 of Genesis 1, that includes the word, after saying replenish the earth, it goes on to say subdue it and have dominion. And we don't see that in this benediction here, but that's not completely true as we'll move through these verses. It's in the verses. The idea of the dominion, the authority and responsibility that man has. But here we have a new world. We have a new chance for mankind. And what we really have is the next step in the revelation of the promised seed. Genesis 3 and verse 15, that proto-evangelium, that first gospel promise that's made, that there would be a seed, that there would be a seed yet to come. And this is that next step. It would seem in some ways that the devil was victorious in corrupting the whole of flesh in its violence and immorality upon the earth. And then God had to deal with them. And yet God took that remnant, the eight, in the ark and brought them over the flood, through the flood. And now he's continuing with the gospel through Noah and his progeny. And so the revelation of the promised seed is clearly going to be helped by God's benediction of fruitfulness. And not only this, but we see added to that benediction is secondly the buffer of fear. There's a buffer of fear. Genesis 9 and verse 2, and the fear of you and the dread of you shall be upon every beast of the earth, and upon every fowl of the air, upon all that moveth upon the earth, and upon all the fishes of the sea, into your hand are they delivered. So not only is mankind to be fruitful, to fill the earth, we are allowed to fill the earth. We're not just to limit ourselves to 1 billion. We are allowed by God to fill the earth, and he provides. I think I touched upon this last time, that with every passing decade, the ability of farmland, agricultural land, and the reduction of it, there seems to be less available farmland on the earth than there used to be, but it's able to produce much more, 10 times more, 100 times more, the same field in southern Alberta, what it could produce 100 years ago, it can now produce at least 100-fold more because of, well, it's because God has decreed it. God has determined that it will be so, and the earth can sustain much more life. It can feed everyone now, if the big business and the politicians would allow them. But this buffer of fear, not only is mankind to be fruitful, but mankind is also to be protected. There's an aspect of protection here. As the Lord puts these eight upon the earth, and they're to be fruitful, to have many children, and their children to have many children, and to fill the earth. And as we examined when we came to Adam and Eve and the time of Abel and Cain and Abel, but more especially when we were looking at Seth, Cain's lineage and then Seth's lineage after that, we could just see that and understand that the numbers would increase massively, so that by Noah, the 10th generation from Adam, that there could easily be millions and millions upon earth, if not billions. Taking the most conservative estimates, we could say there would be 1.2 million, I think, was the reckoning. But that's a very conservative understanding. Too much influenced by modern attitudes towards families and sizes and things. So what does the Lord do then to protect this new Adam and Eve, this new Adna, this new mankind of Noah and his wife and three sons? Well, he places God's fear on the beast and the fowl in a twofold matter we see here. A twofold matter first, the twofold reason is first is to protect the man from the power and the savagery of the beasts. But I would suggest to you also to protect man's new food source from overhunting and overfishing. It's a balance. And if man was to go out and to be too eager, instead of waiting for the crops to grow and the earth to replenish as regarding vegetation, and think it'd be easier just to kill all the animals that we have now, well, then there'd be no animals left. So it's to protect man from the tooth and claw, the red tooth and claw of the beasts, and it's to protect the beasts from man's savagery, shall we say, and short-sighted overhunting and overfishing, which of course can happen. So that is added to which is really a repetition of that dominion mandate that we see in Genesis 1 and verse 28. Is into your hand they are delivered. Into your hand they are delivered. In other words, all of life has been created by God for man's use. And that has not changed. All of life. Of course, there is to be a kindness and a care to animals. There is to be a sensible stewardship by man towards creation, because it is the Creator that has given this gift. You do not despise the giver of... If somebody was to give you something, someone's to give you a really expensive computer, and you thought, oh, that's great, and you would use it as a doorstop. Yeah, or you would just play around with it, juggle it in the air, and it smashes on the ground. Oh, I don't mind. And the person standing there thinking, that cost me $2,000. That would not be a sign of respect or gratitude to the giver of the gift. So as we are given these gifts, as we're given the use of the earth, as we're given the use of animals, as we see now, animals, birds, and fish, that of course there must be a sensible and grateful stewardship to the Creator in how we do these things. But notice with me, though, mankind is therefore, with this dominion, with these rights of usage, is placed above creation. His creation, a man is placed above it. He has dominion. I said not tyranny. He has dominion. He has lordship is what dominion means. He has lordship over creation. He's not equal to it. He's been placed by God above it. And therefore, he should rule as a wise and careful ruler should rule. With wisdom and care, obviously. Because God has given it to him. But man is to make use of it and to enjoy it. He may make use of it and enjoy it. Because beast, fowl, and fish have been given into man's hand. What does that mean, given into your hand? It's been given as possession. It's a gift. It's a gift. So mankind is not merely an equal to the animals, as many in the Green Movement would say. And he's certainly not beneath the creatures, as many human haters there are in politics today. No, he has dominion over the creatures, as the Catechism itself declares, with dominion over the creatures. And so we have a God-given right to possess the land, we have a God-given right to make use of the crops of the land, and we have a God-given right to eat of the creatures of the land. taking care with the gift, but making use of the gift. And so added to this, we have, besides the benediction of fruitfulness for the human, for the building up of the human race, bringing forth the Savior in due course, of course, then the buffer of fear that is to protect the people and to protect man's food source. We see, thirdly, the benefits of food, and that opens this up more clearly, as we see in verse 3. Every moving thing that liveth shall be meat for you, even as the green herb have I given all things. Now, if you remember when we were reading in chapter 1 of Genesis, and we saw that mankind was given various things to eat. I might just turn to the last verses. And God says in verse 29 of Genesis 1, "Behold, I have given you," and he's speaking to Adam and Eve, "every herb bearing seed which is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree in which is the fruit of a tree yielding seed, to you it shall be for meat," meat meaning food. And so we see then that they were given grains, they were given nuts, they were given the herbs of the field, they were given fruit, something that the animals weren't given. They were only given the herb of the field. But they were never openly permitted to eat any of the animals and the birds and the fish. And that's certainly the case in Eden. In Eden, where there was no death, and there was no death because there was no sin. Because there was no sin, no death was the result of it. No sin, no death. With sin, there is death. Now, immediately after the fall, we do read of the death of animals. We read of the Lord in Genesis and chapter 3, towards the end of the third chapter, that we see that in verse 21, "Unto Adam also and to his wife did the Lord make coats of skins and clothe them." So he covered their sinful nakedness, their nakedness which was now sinful. And he covered them with the coats, with the skins of animals. So those animals were sacrificed, as it were. And we consider the fact that, in some way it was an atoning sacrifice, pointing to the atoning sacrifice of Christ. And we see also that not only was their sinful nakedness covered up, but we see later on when Cain and Abel grow up and bring their own sacrifice, or at least when Abel brings a sacrifice, Cain just brings a grain and fruit offering, that a sacrificial animal was offered in that atoning worship. So sacrifice was there. But the eating of animals, it would appear, was never permitted. But it is possible that, just as with Noah, when we read that when Noah brought that sacrifice as they came out of the ark, that he offered burnt offerings on the altar, and we saw that word was whole burnt offerings from that we saw there in the first verses of Leviticus chapter 1. That these sacrifices, therefore, were probably also all whole burnt offerings. That when Abel brought that offering, it was a whole burnt offering. It was all burnt, and therefore there was nothing left over. It's not as though they kept a portion for themselves. There was no fellowship meal with the Lord in that way, as with other sacrifices that we see in the law of Moses. Of course, it is also likely that this is the case, that because man had revolted against God, rebelled, hated God and hated God's standards, the part of that violence that is described to us that filled the whole earth leading up to Moses and up to Noah and the flood, that would include in some way violence to animals. And maybe the unlawful eating of animals, although God had never given man permission, as he gives him clearly now in chapter 9. So it's maybe that is the case also. There was no clear command to eat. Certainly, it was not allowed in Eden because there would be no death. And afterwards, we see it only in the form of sacrifice and of covering, of atonement, which is what atonement really points to, in religious purposes. But now the Lord says, now they are allowed to, as it were, kill and eat, having never before received a divine command or sanction. But it would seem now, even just practically speaking, now we have this world and so much of the vegetation is still yet to grow back, they would need a high protein source of food. Now the earth had been so altered by the flood, and some would suggest, there are great changes that have been made. The protection upon the earth by the waters that were stored, that no longer protected the earth, and that they would need a richer form of food. The earth had altered, and no doubt with all that water had cooled down, and so plant life would grow less richly, and so man would be forced to eat an animal source of protein and not just a vegetable source. So mankind, it seems, is now given permission to eat beast, to eat fowl, and to eat fish. It's God's command. God commands it, and God is holy. Every command of God is righteous and good, and therefore there is nothing immoral in eating meat. Nothing immoral in eating meat in and of itself. There's no moral superiority in being a vegetarian or a vegan, although that would be promoted and said these days, that there is no moral superiority. In fact, it's contrary to what the Bible says. If you personally prefer eating less meat, or you prefer eating more vegetables, or you prefer, because of your digestion, because of the fallen state of your system, you notice eating too much red meat or too much processed pork is bad for you, that's a personal decision. It's not a moral decision. That's a medical decision, not a moral decision. It doesn't say thou shalt eat meat. We're not commanded that we must. But we're certainly not commanded, but we are commanded or given the permission to eat meat. And so the creator of all life, of all things, who gives life to all things, he has given flesh, fish, and fowl for us to enjoy and to eat. None of which, of course, excuses in any way the extremes of factory farming and factory processing of these matters. Let me not to say that, not to say because the Lord says we can eat meat, we can treat the animals as roughly and as terribly as possible, as we wish. That's not what it's being taught here. But we have a God-given right to eat meat, to eat flesh. But the principle is now clearly made, that we may eat meat. Even though it's becoming more and more of a luxury, the Lord has said yes. And I would suggest until the second coming, until the consummation of all things, that we would need to and have a right to eat the meat of animals, of birds, and of fish. But of course, when the Lord returns and makes all things new and sets everything right, I don't believe in eternity that we would be eating meat. I think death would be again anathema in that state of eternal innocency, as it were. And innocency is not the right word. Eternal holiness that would be given to the people of God. The blessings of life quickly move us on to the blood of life. The blood of life, because that's connected very, very tightly in the passage here with the giving of animal life. Here's animal life, but in verse 4, we read of this, that there is a prohibition of eating blood. You may eat flesh, but you may not eat blood. But with flesh, with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall you not eat. So we have this permission given, but there is a prohibition as well. You're not to drink blood. That might seem obvious. It doesn't say drinking blood, but you're not to imbibe. You're not to take blood in, any blood, certainly in this context, animal blood, into you. And there might be very good and practical reasons for doing this. If we consider we're not going to eat meat that's still got its blood in it, hasn't been well bled and all this, and we say, well, there's practical reasons. And people quite often, when they look at the law of Moses and they say, well, there are practical reasons. Yes, no doubt, it is a very healthy not to eat blood. Eat flesh, sorry, that has blood still in it. It doesn't stay as long. Maybe blood-borne diseases would be increased if they just stay in there. No, you want to get the blood out. But that's not the reason the Lord gives us. What is the reason that the Lord gives us? He says, but flesh with the life thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall you not eat. It's because of the blood is the life. The blood is the life. That's why. And that word that's used for life is elsewhere translated as soul. So if you know your Hebrew, that word nephesh, that's the word that's used here. But the flesh with the soul thereof, which is the blood thereof, shall you not eat. The life or the soul is in the blood. So we can see that as being that the life essence of the animal itself is understood to be its blood, because you were to slash an artery of an animal and all of its blood would pour out. Well, its life would pour out. So we can understand it in that way, or maybe in some way that the soul is the life essence in the blood. I mean, it's talking about animals here, not humans. So whichever way we're thinking of, that there is something of the soul in the blood, of the life essence, or it's just referring to the blood being poured out, either of those two, I mean, they're connected anyway. There's not much difference. But it's not to teach us this, that an animal or a bird has a spiritual soul like a human. That's not what it's speaking to us of. The word soul, as I said, it means life. It means life. And now it's not meant to teach us this also, by the way, that the soul sort of floats around in the blood in some way. And therefore, if you were to have blood transfusions, you'd be mixing your soul with someone else's soul. And that's the false teaching of the Jehovah's Witnesses. That's why they are against blood transfusions, believing that the soul is in the blood in some special way. And then if you were to have a blood transplant, you know, you'd suddenly start speaking in a, say it was a Scottish accent or something, because the donor was Scottish, and you suddenly started liking haggis that you'd never liked before. Whatever it was, I mean, we know that's not the truth. Haggis is nice, by the way, but that's not the truth about what blood transfusions are. There is no mixing of souls. But what the Lord is teaching us, besides the fact that an animal or bird does not have the soul that a human has, and that the soul is not sort of in the blood and can sort of be shared or poured out in that way. But what he is teaching us is this, is a very simple truth. No bizarre theology in that case, but he's teaching us the sanctity of life and the sanctity of blood. And they are connected. They're connected, of course. The life of all creatures that have blood is in their blood. And so he's speaking of animals, but he's also speaking of humans as he moves into verse 5, and we'll look at it in a minute. But it is in the life of the humans. Life, death, and blood are matters, are most serious matters personally. But you do realize that life, death, and blood are spiritually very important matters, as we discover in the gospel. So the Lord wants us to be very clear about this, and to understand that we don't play around with life or death, that we don't play around with blood, because that has a special role to play, a very special role to play in the whole of the scripture, in the whole of redemptive history. And I suppose if we wanted to understand something from this and have a personal application, does that mean that we're not to eat blood pudding or black pudding, whatever you want to call it? Does that mean that we're not to eat products that contain hemoglobin? Well, I would say, yes, indeed, we're not to eat those. Because these were given to, these commandments, these warnings were given to Noah well before the time of Moses and the law. We understand that Moses and the law and the dietary requirements that are given in the law have ceased with Christ, have ceased with his work on the cross and his ascension into heaven, that they have now all the dietary requirements that were in the law have been fulfilled in Christ, having been taught certain spiritual truths in those strict dietary laws. Now then, they are no longer the case. They have been done away with. And the consuming of blood and blood products, though, was never repealed in the New Testament. It was never repealed. In fact, it was enforced. It was reinforced. It was confirmed. In Acts 15, we have that the Council of Jerusalem, or the first great Presbytery assembly. It says its findings of that assembly were this, that Gentile converts, in verse 29 of Acts 15, it says this, that ye abstain from meats, that is flesh, offered to idols, and from blood, and from things strangled, and from fornication, from which if ye keep yourselves, ye shall do well, fare ye well. So in the context of Gentile converts coming into a newly Christianized synagogue, being aroused by Jewish converts to Christ and being made very clear, these are the things that you need to do. So all those other matters, including circumcision, are of no more force for the Christian church in general, making it very clear to the Gentile converts. And they, again, he emphasizes then, on the other side of New Testament revelation and the work of Christ, that again, believers are to abstain from blood, from blood products, from blood still in the meat, which is what strangled means here. And we're to keep away from that. It's still forbidden just as much as immorality is still forbidden. And you might say to yourself, well, I love black pudding. It's nothing like a nice slice of black pudding that's fried. Yeah, of course you might like it. There's lots of things that we like. But the Lord has forbidden them. I know there are Reformed men who would not agree with that, but they would be pointing to the Mosaic law and saying, well, the law of Moses says we're not allowed to, but that's all been now changed by Christ. That's true. But now when we're talking about blood, the consuming of blood and of blood in flesh, that was well before Moses, as we're reminded after Christ in the book of Acts. So we have the prohibition of blood, and that really points to the sanctity of human life. But that's further emphasized for the punishment of shedding blood. So the prohibition of eating blood, followed by the punishment for shedding blood in the following verse. In verse 5, and surely your blood of your lives will I require. And then he says, at the hand of every beast will I require. That's not saying that beasts have hands, of course. It's an expression at the hand of, by the, it's a Hebrew expression meaning by the action of. Hand is an active part of the body. And surely at the hand of every beast will I require it, and at the hand of man, it's the same expression, at the hand of every man's brother will I require the life of a man. So the Lord has determined now, as we take all of these things together that we've looked at since verse 1, the Lord is determined to preserve man's life from attack by the beasts. He's then desired and determined to sustain man's life by the eating of the flesh. He then goes on to warn mankind from eating blood in any form, because life is precious and life is in the blood. Blood is precious. And now he adds to that truth, we see, adds to the truth of the sanctity of life, and says very clearly, I am your divine judge in these matters. I am your divine judge, and he is there waiting to avenge the unlawful taking of blood, whether by beast or by man. If any man's life, any man, woman, boy and girl, we understand, if their lives are taken by beast or by man, then God will judge. God sees and God will judge. We touched upon the third commandment this morning in the adult Bible class. In the same way that God sees and hears and will judge those that take his name in vain, he sees and he hears the murder of life, the taking away of life. And very interestingly, he doesn't just say, the hand of every beast will I require and the hand of every man, but then he goes on to say, at the hand of every man's brother will I require. And I would consider this, that's more than a mere echo of the very first murder between brother and brother. Here we hear that truth that Cain killed Abel, the murder of your own brother, is explicitly mentioned. Why? I think to emphasize this, that you are your brother's keeper. Do you remember that first murder? That first murder came because he had the attitude that he wasn't his brother's keeper. He didn't have a responsibility to the life of others. He does. A positive responsibility to care and look after. And that responsibility that would be in the commandment not to kill. And so we're reminded, yes, we are our brother's keeper. We are to keep our brothers in life, our own life and other people's lives as well. And so this is an earnest matter that the Lord gives us here concerning the shedding of blood. And he goes so far, and we'll understand this now as we go into the next and the final point, that he goes on to lay the very foundations of civil law in these words. You say, well, this seems far-fetched. It's not. We will look at the words and understand clearly that the Lord is unfolding something, that there will be an establishment, or at least laying the foundations of the establishment of civil law. So the blessings of life, and then we've seen the blood of life, and finally the body of law. The body of law, especially shown to us in verse 6. Verse 6 says, whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed, for in the image of God made he man. And so that verse then adds to that truth that God himself will see to it that the murder is dealt with. The Lord's not just going to let it happen. Even though murder and violence may fill the world, the Lord is going to make sure that it's dealt with. And it reveals a number of matters. Firstly, that the authority that has been imparted, there is an authority that has been imparted to mankind. God makes it clear that through the working of man, through the word, the mediacy of man, By using man, God himself will deal with the murderers of man. It is not the fact that every time that somebody does something terrible and murder is a terrible crime, it's a terrible sin, that every time someone does that, a lightning bolt will come down from heaven. God is not circumventing the authorities that he has ordained. In fact, he's teaching us here what we can then carry on to read in Romans 13 to some degree, or we will read in Romans 13 shortly, about the role that the God-ordained authorities have. That is not only to prevent murder in law, but also to punish murder. And we certainly know, maybe in our own experience, and if you don't know this, I'll explain now, when a domesticated animal goes wild, when it becomes a shedder of human blood, whether it's a dog or it's a bull, then what happens immediately, well, it should happen, is that it's put down. Immediately, it's tasted blood, it's known that it's able to rebel against human authority, and therefore it's now become an unsure thing. It's become a dangerous thing. And so it is to be put down, whether it's a pit bull terrier or whether it's an Aberdeen Angus bull. And it should be put down, but also we see the Lord here gives clearly man the right to legally avenge murder also. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. It doesn't say may be shed, or could be, or should be. We see here the command, the word of commandment. Whoso sheddeth man's blood, by man shall his blood be shed. So this is not just a biblical remit for the death penalty. It's a command for the death penalty. A very unpopular thing to say, of course, these days, where man has lost all moral and spiritual backbone in the case of law. But to legally avenge murder, any breaker of the sixth commandment must have his or her blood shed. Whereby we understand this when the Lord says this, that firstly there must be an apprehension of the guilty, there must be some sort of police force, there must be some sort of guard or sheriff, there must be some magistrate who is sent out to arrest them on behalf of the law, because that must be in the law. And secondly, their guilt or innocence must be determined by honest and fair process. There must be some form of legal hearing with a judge. And thirdly then, upon their guilt being discovered, their blood is then to be shed. So there is to be some sort of system, an executioner appointed. And those things that I've mentioned that are the logical consequences of God commanding that the murderer's blood be shed set down the framework for the office and the duty of the civil magistrate. In fact, as I was reading Karl-Heinz Rabast, a really good professor on Genesis, he was seeing that this is really the foundation of the state. This goes on to form the very foundation of the state. So we have law, we have the breaking of law, we have the arrest of the lawbreaker, we have the judgment of the breaker, and we have then the judgment that's carried out. And it is the framework then for the office and duty of civil magistrate. And in the context, it is in order to protect God-given life. Now that same principle, I mentioned, we look at Romans 13. The same principle is taught in Romans 13, where the magistrates are described there in verse 4 as the minister of God. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain. For he is the minister of God, the servant of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. And therefore, human civil authorities have a God-given authority, yes, and God-given duty to deal clearly and biblically with murderers. It's a clear aspect then therefore, as we understand this, that we have the divine right to use the death penalty. It's a divine command, is also a divine right, that those that shed blood should have their blood shed. And who is responsible for that? Man. We are to police, according to the scriptures, as it were, we are to police ourselves. And we set up magistrates, we set up judges and sheriffs and the like. And we have a God-given duty to do that. It is a God-given duty for the Christian to see that the death penalty be put back on the statute books. because it's a divine command. It is a serious punishment, yes, for a most serious crime, the death penalty. But it does rid society of manslayers. Doesn't keep them. They can't escape the coffin. They can escape the penitentiary, but they can't escape the coffin. Because we know that those who kill once can easily kill again. And of course, the death penalty is a deterrent to hold back those who would yet murder. And of course, then we have the whole cost to society of incarcerating prisoners, those who have been accused of murder. Say first-degree murder, I believe that's the expression that may be used here as well. First-degree murder or of murder, not manslaughter, but murder. That to keep that prisoner watered, fed, and sheltered is a costly business. Now, there is different degrees of security. Let's just presume a murderer goes into maximum security. Well, he's $92,000+ a year to keep them. $92,000. To me, it's $47,000 for minimum security. But for maximum security, it's $92,000. For all women at any level of security, it's all $83,000. So let's just say that somebody gets for first-degree murder 25 years. Well, that would cost the taxpayer $1.2 million for that prisoner. And so there is a great, and it's not for the expense. I point out the expense because it reveals the foolishness, the folly, and the self-righteousness of following unbiblical policies, that the Lord just curses us with the ridiculousness of having thousands and thousands of prisoners that are kept and probably in better condition than a number of people in society who have not broken the law. So the authority that is imparted to man to deal with this thing, and secondly, because of the authority that is worn, W-O-R-N, as in clothes are worn. Because the ultimate reason for the value of a human life, in stark contrast to animals that may be slaughtered for food, is that man is made in the image of God. Man is made in the image of God, and you all were the image of God. On the inside and the outside, the image of God is there. The image of God is marred. And when we were examining verses 27 and 28 of chapter 1 of Genesis, indeed, we touched upon that because the Lord said, let us make man in our own image. And we were looking at that then. But what we understand is the divine image has been put onto man, is being put into man, and therefore it makes every human life precious, whether that life is in the womb, whether that life is terminally ill, whether that life is very ancient in years and needs a lot of help to live, whether that life is a liberal life or a conservative life or a communist life, it doesn't matter. That life is precious. And that's why you're not allowed to hate that life. We're not allowed to hate. We're supposed to love our neighbor and love our enemies. So even those who are against us, we are to love them. We are to realize that we are to love them because they are also made in the image of God. And that life is declared precious, not only because God gave them life, but he gave them an immortal soul with which to love God and to live a conscious life with God. The Lord breathed life and a living soul, breathed life or air into Adam's nostrils, and he became a living soul. That soul, that image of God, and there's much to be considered about that, and we won't look into the details now, but when we look at Genesis 1 and then we have the help of the New Testament, it describes to us that the image of God that was lost is in holiness, righteousness, knowledge. We understand from Genesis 1 also dominion. Dominion is part of that. And of course, which should be added is this relationship. Relationship is also part of that image of God. As we understand something of the Trinity, we understand something of the covenant of grace. It's all about relationship. Part of the image of God. And when that image is marred by murder, we see that God is ill-pleased, that his majestic and holy image has been marred, has been killed. That person, although they may not love the Lord, and yet they're still made in the image of God. That's one of the reasons why, it's not the only reason, but it's one of the reasons why God says that we are to love our enemy. They too are made in the image of God. There's a challenge, of course, to love your enemy, to pray for them, to bless them, to help them. And of course, every sin to some degree mars the image of God within ourselves and within other people. Another example of a sin that mars the image of God is the sins of the tongue that we see in James 3. In verses 6 to 10, speaking of the sins of gossip and slander and cursing, that, as we say, the murdering of somebody's character and reputation by the use of the tongue. James writes, and the tongue is a fire, a world of iniquity. So is the tongue among our members, that it defileth the whole body and setteth on fire the course of nature, and it is set on fire of hell. For every kind of beasts and of birds and of serpents and of things in the sea is tamed and hath been tamed of mankind, but the tongue can no man tame. It is an unruly evil, full of deadly poison. Therewith bless we God, even the Father, and therewith curse we men, which are made after the similitude of God. Out of the same mouth proceedeth blessing and cursing. My brethren, these things ought not so to be. So we see there's an application of everything that we're reading there in not everything, but this last part that we're considering here in chapter 9 and verse 6. For in the image of God made he man. The authority that's imparted to deal with the murderer and the death penalty thereby. The authority that is worn, we all bear the image of God. There's much more to be said on that, but this is a passing thought. That's the reason that God gives. The reason why we are to have the death penalty is because any that would take the life of man must be punished, because they have marred and disregarded the image of God in that person's life. Thirdly, the authority owned. And then we'll finish with this. The authority owned. So we've considered the high value of human life, far higher than what we hear of in the world and see in the world. You know, your life is yours for the taking, they say, unless it's an unborn child, and then it's their life is yours for the taking, which of course is wickedness. So we've considered the high value of human life that God gives to it. We don't, but God does, because it bears that glorious image of God, however damaged it is by sin. And so let us then, let that profound truth be contrasted with what we've been witnessing of the Lord's doing in the previous three chapters. God says, human life is of great value. It bears my image. It is of great value that you may not shed its blood. You may not kill. And if you do kill, you yourself will be killed. That's what the Lord declares and decrees clearly in these verses. But what have we seen? Well, we have seen God's righteous judgment over millions, maybe billions of human lives. Now that is a stark contrast, of course. The Lord says, human's life is precious, you're not allowed to take it. And yet he's just washed billions off the face of the earth. Now some might see that as a contradiction. It is not. Certainly not a contradiction. God judged them soul for soul. He condemned them soul for soul. And he dealt with them. He dealt with their bodies here on earth. And as we understand from Peter, they're still in hell. They're still in hell. Their soul is still being dealt with. But they have that eternal soul that the Lord has created within them. And that soul will never die. It's his righteous judgment of those that do not value the image of God in themselves. They do not value God at all. And here's the interesting comparison. They live like animals, and they have thoughts like devils. That's a good description of a sinner, unrepentant toward God. Bestial and devilish, diabolical. And so they consciously mar the image of God in themselves as also being murderers. And whatever else they would do to their fellow human being. Which brings us to that point that you will often hear people say, and it's an expression that people like to hear, and people who should actually sit at home and read their Bibles and read some good theology before they open their mouths are wise to hear the rebuke of. And people say, well, God hates the sin and loves the sinner. Well, no, the Lord did not wash the earth of sin and keep the sinner alive. One is not separate from the other. The soul that sins, it shall die. It's not true that God hates sin and loves the sinner. It's not true. You say, hang on. But that's what I've heard. Yes, you've heard, but you've heard wrong. You've heard correctly, but it is wrong. The Bible teaches that God hates sin and loves the repentant sinner. God hates sin and loves the repentant sinner. But the unrepentant sinner dies in his sin and because of his sin. I'll just throw that out there. Everyone dies because of their sin. They don't die because of the decree of God from all eternity. They die because of their sin. And this emphasizes the truth that only God ultimately has the right to avenge all sin, including murder, because he only is the righteous judge of all the earth. So in closing then, we understand, let this thought remain with us, let it abide with us as we leave the house of the Lord this morning, is that all life is precious. Yes, black lives matter, and I use those words not in the political way, but unborn lives matters, elderly lives matters, human life is precious because God has created it and created with his precious image in it and on it. And yes, sin mars that image, but that gives us no excuse. That gives us no excuse. And now, however you might have had murderous thoughts against the rulers of this country in the last weeks or months, that person is also created in the image of God. It's God that gives that value, and he wants us to understand, therefore they have that value, even though sin takes it away. And therefore, having considered other people and the value of their lives and how we are to treat them and how we are to treat those that would take away their lives, you also need to be very careful that you do not throw away your own life, that you do not kill yourself. Am I talking of suicide? Well, yes. Yes, suicide is a breaking of the sixth commandment, thou shalt not kill. Thou shalt not kill yourself. But also throwing away your life and not making good use of every 24 hours that the Lord gives. Yeah, so you have that idea of wasting your life, being lazy, being unmotivated or whatever. But the point I want to get to this morning as we close is I'm talking about spiritual suicide. Spiritual suicide. What's spiritual suicide? Well, that's what you commit when you don't believe the gospel and you therefore die in your sins. That's what it is. You're not allowed to kill yourself by remaining in your sin. You're not allowed to kill yourself by remaining under God's wrath. You're not allowed to avoid the only way of salvation, which is Christ. And then Christ comes and he says something which seems to contradict this, because he then commands you to give up your life. But what he means is to give up your sinful life, to give up your unbelieving life, to give up your life that is at enmity against God, to give up your Christless life. Because when you give up your sinful life and you give up your Christless life, do you know what the Bible also calls that? Repenting and believing. Repenting and believing. And as the Lord himself, he said in that beautiful gospel promise in Matthew 16 and verse 25, for whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. I'll say that once more. For whosoever will save his life shall lose it, and whosoever will lose his life for my sake shall find it. And may God bless his word to our every heart. This morning, let us briefly pray. Our merciful God and Father, we do thank thee for thy blessed word, We thank thee for these truths that we've been confronted with, and thine high estimation of the human life that thou hast given, and that image of God, the image is so marred with sin, and that image which is to be restored in Jesus Christ. Oh, there were so many other matters that we could have considered. But we pray, O Lord, that thou will have mercy upon us and bless thy word to us. Lord, that word, may it rest and remain. And may it do that work of sanctification or conviction, that it will do us good. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's please stand to sing our closing song, which is Psalm 40. Psalm 40. I waited for the Lord my God and patiently did bear. At length to me he did incline my voice and cry to hear. And we'll sing all verses 1 to 7 and 7th verse a cappella, please.
Bye.
Lord. We do thank Thee once again for this time to gather into Thy presence. O Lord, to hear Thy speaking voice straight to our souls. We pray, O Lord, once again for Thy mercy to be upon us, to send us home, Lord, with Thy favor and Thy fear, to bring us back again to Thy worship this evening. Lord, we do pray, have mercy upon us and bless that going forth of Thy word to have effect, Lord, in our lives, that we may love the Lord more and be more humbled before Him. We pray these things in Jesus' name and receive the benediction, the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the communion of the Holy Ghost be with you all. Amen.